It's the most mind-blowing sentence ever uttered by a Nobel Prize-winning scientist. The universe is not locally real. For thousands of years, mystics have been telling us that separation is an illusion, and now science is starting to catch up. Today I'm going to look at three Nobel Prize-winning breakthroughs and how they could be validation for non-duality. I'll show you how these discoveries have shaken the materialist worldview and how they show that the observer and the observed are not separate from each other. So let's start by taking a look at probably the most radical of them all, the 2022 Nobel Prize in Physics. In 2022, Alan Aspect, John Clauser, and Anton Zellinger won the Nobel Prize in Physics for experiments involving quantum entanglement and violations of the Bell inequalities. Their findings forced the scientific community to accept a deeply unsettling truth, that the universe is not locally real. Local realism is the idea that things exist independently from each other, and that things are only influenced by their immediate surroundings. The experiments showed that these assumptions collapsed under scrutiny. First, locality breaks down. Entangled particles act as one system, no matter how far apart they are from each other. Change the state of one, and the other responds instantly. Not quickly, instantly. Distance becomes irrelevant. This hints at what non-duality has been telling us, that separation exists only in the mind, not in the world itself. As the Chandogya Upanishad says, where there is duality, one sees another. But when everything has become the self, then what can one see, and by what? Second, realism breaks down. Particles do not have fixed properties until they are observed. There is no world out there with independent attributes waiting to be discovered. Reality arises in relationship. The observer and the observed are two sides of one process. This mirrors the Buddhist view of dependent origination, and also the Taoist view that the world is a flowing process, not a collection of separate things. Anton Zellinger himself has said that the boundary between information and reality becomes blurred. In other words, reality is not a collection of things, it is a web of relationships. And relationship implies unity. And when science steps away from the idea of self-existing independent objects, it is stepping into the territory of non-duality, whether it intends to or not. Now let's go back 100 years to another Nobel Prize, Niels Bohr in 1922. Bohr's great insight was the principle of complementarity. This is the idea that truth is often revealed in pairs of opposites that only make sense together. Light behaves like particles and waves. Electrons behave like point-like objects and smooth fields. You cannot describe reality with a single perspective. You need both. Interestingly, when Niels Bohr was knighted, he chose the yin-yang symbol as his coat of arms, with the motto, Contraria sunt complementa. Opposites are complementary. This was his way of saying the universe is non-dual. Opposites are not enemies. They arise together. They define each other. Subject and object, mind and matter, self and world. Bohr himself even drew parallels between quantum physics and Taoism. In Taoism, the interplay of yin and yang gives rise to the 10,000 things. In quantum mechanics, the interplay of wave and particle gives rise to the behavior of matter. In both cases, reality is not made of things, it is made of relationships. This is non-duality in scientific language. A decade later, in 1933, another Nobel Prize was awarded, this time to Erwin Schrödinger, for his development of wave mechanics. His wave equation describes matter as a continuous field, not a set of discrete particles. What we call a particle is simply an expression of a universal wave. Schrödinger was deeply influenced by Vedanta. He read the Upanishads extensively, and he openly said that his understanding of the Vedas and of quantum physics were two expressions of the same thing. His most famous statement reflects this. He said, consciousness is a singular, of which the plural is unknown. In other words, there is only one consciousness. The idea that there are multiple minds is just a useful fiction. This is Advaita Vedanta in precise scientific language. It is the Buddha's teaching that there is no separate self. and it is the Christian mystic's idea of divine union. When we look for consciousness in the brain, we find processes, not a self. When we look for particles in the atom, we find fields, not objects. When we look for independent entities in the universe, we find entanglement, not separateness. The deeper you go, the more unity you find. Across cultures and across millennia, mystics have described the same insight in multiple ways. The Upanishads called it Brahman, the Buddhists called it Nirvana, the Christian mystics called it divine union, Lao Tzu called it the Tao, modern physics calls it non-locality and complementarity, Schrödinger called it one mind, and Buck called it cosmic consciousness. Non-duality isn't an abstract philosophy, it is a shift in lived consciousness. Quantum mechanics says the observer and the observed are inseparable, and non-duality says you and the world arise together. Wave mechanics says that what looks like many things is actually a single field, and non-duality says all forms are expressions of one reality. Complementarity says opposites reveal each other. Non-duality says the tension between self and other dissolves. Science reveals the structure. Spirituality reveals the lived experience. When science lacks spirituality, it becomes cold. When spirituality lacks scientific literacy, it edges towards superstition. But when they meet, something beautiful happens. You begin to recognize that every single experience, from the movement of atoms to the movement of your own thoughts, is one continuous dance of the same underlying being. And you are not separate from it. You are it. If you want to explore more connections between science and non-duality, watch this video next.